Megan Rose is a high achiever. That goes to her playing days. That goes to what she does in tennis today. She is an inspirational figure, and we're going to tell you and show you all the reasons why. This is the On to Something podcast. I'm Brian Fenley, an anchor at Fox Sports Radio, and I help out as a commentator on the Challenger Tour for the USTA. She is Megan, managing director, major events, USTA, also team leader, Team USA tennis. So she's got a lot to do when it comes to tennis. This is something that has been a big part of who she is, the fabric of who she is. And I think, Megan, as I welcome you in here, if we were to take like a tennis tactic and say the way in which you attack the game, are you that aggressive baseliner when it comes to your work now? Or how would you sum up the way in which you go about your work?
Well, thanks a lot for having me. This is a really a pleasure. I've enjoyed the podcast, and so I'm happy to be here today. You know, that's a good question. No one has asked me that before. It's interesting. I think starting my career, definitely aggressive baseliner, trying to just get to everything and trying to just be as many places as I could be and get as much experience and meet as many people as possible. And now I'm trying to move more to encouraging a doubles partner and encouraging the team and sitting on the bench. I mean, that would kind of be the direction I would love to move into. But no, I mean, as of right now, I'm having a great time and super lucky with everything that I've been able to work on and to such an incredible team that I get to work with.
Hard to find a better doubles partner than your husband, Jesse, considering all that he's done in encouraging you, believing in you, maybe at times when you didn't believe as much in yourself. How has he been there for you? And how much do you give in terms of what he's done to progress your career based upon the way in which he has been that encouraging presence in your life?
I mean, look, I think nothing that I do or have done basically since I met him has been, was possible without him. I mean, honestly, I think, even just moving to Orlando, he was from St. Petersburg, grew up in St. Pete, friends with all of the same friends from, you know, elementary school. And I basically said, I have this amazing opportunity in Orlando. Would you consider moving? We left both sets of grandparents, so we're probably the dumbest parents on the planet to leave free childcare. But he literally, the only question he asked was, do I get to play tennis at the national campus? And I said, yes. He's like, all right, cool. When are we leaving? So, you know, Stacey Alliser, my boss and mentor, you know, she had always talked a lot about the importance of finding, you know, a supportive partner, because it's true. You know, it's hard for anyone, let alone, you know, someone with a family, a partner, kids, you know, even if you don't have kids, just trying to manage personal and professional life. And so having someone that not only, you know, supports it, but encourages it, I think that's really the key, right? It's knowing that if I have to leave for a couple of weeks, that he's holding down the fort and he's not making me feel bad about it. And he's continuing to just be my biggest cheerleader. I mean, I don't think that can be overstated how critical that is to me being able to continue to follow my dreams in sport.
Megan Rose is with us. I'm Brian Fenley. Speaking of manning the fort, when you think about the USTA and all of the women who are in such powerful positions, what is it about the USTA that really gets it when it comes to elevating the presence of women in high-profile positions and how they really are a leader in that world of making sure that there is that equality and making sure everybody's getting opportunities?
Yeah, look, the USTA has been a leader in a lot of ways, right? I mean, we were the first Grand Slam with equal prize money for the women at the US Open. You know, Katrina Adams being our first African-American president. We had women in leadership positions at the presidency of the USTA, you know, for quite a while now throughout different times. And then, you know, from a national perspective with Stacey Alliser and, you know, Andrea Hirsch really kind of leading the charge, as well as several others in the C-suite that are strong, powerful women. I think it continues to just be completely inspiring and motivational for those of us that are in the organization that are looking to continue to make, you know, to make our way and to also support the ongoing mission of the organization. I think the USTA continues to see that it's important to have diverse voices in the room. It's not, you know, no longer is it acceptable or even good business to just have the same kind of people thinking the same way, coming from the same backgrounds. You know, I think, we continue to work on other areas of diversity. And as a woman of color, you know, in a sport that's predominantly been, you know, managed by, you know, white men, I've been trying, you know, to continue to try to follow in the footsteps of people like Stacey and Andrea, and also just looking to serve as kind of lifting as I rise, right? Pulling people along behind me and helping, you know, provide a path for other women as they're looking to make their mark in sport. But it is certainly amazing to be at the USTA and to be on calls where there's all, you know, female leaders, you know, on a Zoom call together, or seeing someone like Stacey being the first tournament director of the US Open and being out on Arthur Ashe Stadium and you know, and Billie Jean King and, you know, National Tennis Center, and being able to hand over those trophies at the US Open continues to just be, you know, an inspiring thing that I'm able to kind of see firsthand.
Speaking of being inspirational, how much of a duty do you feel to lift those who are coming up, the next generation, to what you were able to do as far as showing them by what you do that anything is possible? And you've taken it upon yourself to help lift up the next generation in tennis to say that, hey, I'm that inspirational presence, and these are all the opportunities that you can have. Look what I've done. Now it's your turn to succeed as well.
I mean, I've been a recipient of just some incredible, you know, guidance from female leaders and also from male allies, right? I mean, that's the important part too, is that the idea of progress is that it's not just that someone else has to, you know, has to give up a seat necessarily, but at least pull up another chair next to you, right? So, but it does take allies, and it does take people who have been in those positions of power to understand that it does take, you know, bravery for people to look behind them and help people reach up and pull themselves up. You know, I think fortunately we're moving out of the generation where women had to basically fight each other to be the only woman in the room. And now we're in a better position where there are more women, you know, in the room, there are more women leaders. And so for me, the most important thing, one, is showing, you know, showing that I'm still working, right? Like, I think sometimes people get in positions of leadership and they kind of sit back and kind of have everybody else do the work for them. But the work is still something that I really love to do. And so I know that I'm not asking anyone to do something that I myself haven't done or still continue to do. And so for me too, it's looking at other women in the organization or other women in events or programs that I'm a part of, whether that be WISE, whether that be other organizations that I'm part of in the Orlando area, but just being there for them to ask questions. You know, a lot of times just being open to taking phone calls. You know, I'm on a mentor platform where, you know, students will call me and ask me questions about my path and my journey. And it's hard for me to think that I'm at a position where people actually want to hear what I have to say, because it doesn't feel like it was that long ago where, you know, I was just kind of getting started. But I do find that, you know, I feel a really strong, you know, sense of responsibility to help, at least to help show what potential paths are, potential options are, because I really feel like I've had a lot of experience in different areas of the business, and coming up as a player, I think is also, you know, a unique pathway, and just being able to show that there are opportunities when you get done playing for those. But yeah, I do feel a strong responsibility to try to help as many people as I can kind of that are looking to get into this business, because it is such a rewarding one.
When it comes to your playing days, and you were at Miami for a couple of years and eventually would be named to the Hall of Fame, and I was listening to your induction speech, and I'm curious, because you were in front of a large audience and you could see the pride streaming down your face, and the way in which you were able to finally get that recognition that was so overdue for you with your contributions at the collegiate tennis level. But how has your experiences at Miami, the culture of being part of that program and loving that environment, how do you feel that you've taken some of those times and learned and used that to the way in which you work and govern each day today, from the experiences that you took at Miami, and how you still find, even today, with everything you're doing at the USTA on a daily basis, that you're still using tactics and things you learned and experiences to what you're doing nowadays?
Yeah, I mean, my time at Miami was so foundational. You know, what I learned at Miami has built such a huge part of who I am as a person, and I think who I am as a leader. And I think that was two reasons. I mean, one, Paige Yaroshuk-Tews was my coach, and she taught me, I think most importantly, how every person is an individual. And so she coached us all completely individually. So the what worked for me and the tactics that worked for me as a player did not work for, say, our number two player or number six player. And so she would really get to know all of us personally. And so I think that's been a really strong piece of the way that I lead now, is that recognizing that it's important to get to know people. You can't just, you know, have someone join your team and then you just start barking orders at them, or you think that the way that they are going to take feedback is the way that you want to take feedback or receive feedback. And so really looking at individualized approaches to leadership, I think, has been really important. And she taught me the value of hard work. I mean, there were no days, you know, even on days where I was, you know, still number one in the country, I mean, she did not let up, right? I mean, you have to always assume that there is something that you can get better at every day, and that you should be giving 100%. You know, and then also just being part of that program. I mean, that was the golden era of Miami football. You know, it was the golden era of you know, athletics at Miami, and being in the training room and seeing those athletes that are, you know, winning national championships, and they're still getting after it on Monday, and they're back to work. And, you know, there was just kind of this idea that you work for what you want, and you don't give up until you continue to achieve it. And after you achieve it, then you pick another goal and you keep going. And so I think that time at Miami, I mean, really built me for everything that I am. And it taught me some really hard lessons, but also taught me how to kind of overcome adversity. And coming back from shoulder surgery and kind of going through all of that recovery process, you know, and I was really proud that we were part of a group that really built the program. You know, when I started there, we were a middle 30s kind of ranked team, high 40s. And then when we left, you know, when I left the next year, they were in the finals of NCAAs. And I don't think that they've been outside of the top 25, you know, since. So it's been amazing to be able to contribute to that program, and still just so thankful for Paige and all the other people, all my teammates that were at Miami, because it really, you know, it changes you. I think for me, it was for the better.
Megan Rose is our guest. I'm Brian Fenley. So extracting some of the points from that last response, obviously what you've done is the hard work, the drive, all of these things are part of your fabric of who you are. This is the common denominator of what you've done and why you've had the success. We all, like, in a way, want to live up to our family's name. And obviously, with all the athletic success that your dad had playing Major League Baseball, how much of your drive is, in a way, to live up to what he did or overtake him as far as your competitive drive to succeed, whether you're competing as a player or making it now from a corporate level at the USTA?
It's interesting. I've never really thought about it as overtaking him. I mean, the joke always from when I was a kid was that there was never an article written about me that would ever win anything like this. It was like Megan Bradley was my name back then, but Megan Bradley, comma, daughter of former Major League Baseball player Phil Bradley. You know, that was always the starting sentence of an article. And look, I think ultimately what having a father that plays professional baseball did was it showed me hard work, and it showed me, you know, the value that sport can bring, you know, not just from, you know, obviously there's great benefits of, you know, the lifestyle that you're able to live. But for him, it was all about the love of the game. It was all about the love of competing. It was all about contributing and being a good teammate. So all of those things, I think, are just inherently kind of passed down to me and my brother. I think my brother had it harder just as far as trying to live up to his expectations, because he played football, he played baseball. And so for me, being in tennis, it was a sport that no one in my family had competed in. And honestly, now, you know, I'm really the first person in my family to kind of build a corporate career. And so I feel like I've been able to kind of carve my own path and my own journey in that regard. And you know, I've been able to do some stuff that, you know, my dad hasn't done. You know, he finally saw me in Sports Business Journal, and that, I think, was like, for him, that meant that, you know, I had made it or something, or like, I, you know, oh, you do have a real job, you know, because it was in Sports Business Journal. So, but it's been nice, I think, just having a family that understands the rigor of sport and also the benefits of it has been something that's really been kind of the fabric of our family. And it's also kind of now part of my own family with my husband. You know, we're all competitive, and my kids are in sports now. And, you know, sports is the greatest thing, I think, in the world. So it's been great to just have my life be you know, woven with sport opportunities. I mean, how cool is that, right? I love it.
To see where you are right now, considering that there was one point right after your playing career where you were answering phone calls, sorting out the mail as a receptionist at the WTA. What would the young version, what would you like to tell right now, the younger version of yourself who was just trying to break in the business to say, hey, one day, just watch, it's all going to work out?
I mean, honestly, it would probably be that. It was, you know, when I started as a receptionist, honestly, I know I was just doing that to pay some bills to get through grad school. I had zero plans or aspirations to be in tennis at all. I really was getting my master's in journalism and really wanted to pursue that career path. And I was ready to kind of leave tennis in the dust. And then, you know, life works out in a funny way, right? And so when I came back to tennis after I coached the Princeton, and then when I came back to the WTA, you know, then that's really, really where I started to think that, you know, maybe that life and on the business side of tennis was really where I wanted to build my career. And then that's when I would go back and tell myself, just, you know, just chill out a bit, you know, like it's going to be okay. Everything's going to happen. Doors are going to open for you. Just keep working hard and keep contributing, keep learning. But certainly I think as an athlete, you're always looking to what the next goal is. And so I think, you know, in tennis, and I've said this before, tennis is, it's great because if you work hard and you play and you win, you move up in the rankings. Like there's nothing really to prevent you from success, right? And then you get to corporate America, and then all of a sudden you're dealing with office politics, you're dealing with a flat organization, you're dealing with, oh, we don't have promotions available right now, we don't have raises available right now. And so even you could do everything that's asked of you, but there could still be roadblocks that are kind of preventing you from getting to where you want to go. And it's completely outside of your control. Some people might say I'm a bit of a control freak. So that would make sense that made me a little bit uneasy. But I do think that as I've continued to kind of grow in my career, I've felt more settled, you know, that I don't feel like I'm having to constantly look ahead and be like, what's next? What's next? What's next? Because I really feel like I'm in a place now where I have a portfolio that I'm really proud of that excites me every day when I go to work. It's something that I get to work with an incredible team and be led by an amazing leader and have great colleagues and great support from the organization. And so I would definitely go back to that, you know, manager at the WTA, Megan, and say like, just, it's okay. You know, like just enjoy this process, enjoy where you are and keep working and looking for that door to open.
Through that process in your post-playing career, where have you found, like you kind of were talking about the challenges in the workplace, but where perseverance has been something that you've latched onto the most? When there were times when maybe doubt came in, when there were times when things weren't going your way, but by staying persistent and being able to hone in on that perseverance, you're able to find a way like you've always done over the course of your career.
Yeah, look, I think that's probably been more true since I joined the USTA. There's just been some, you know, really, I think, tough situations to overcome. Not just for me personally, I think just as an organization, there's been a lot of changes. We went through COVID. You know, it was public knowledge that the USTA had a lot of layoffs last year. And then, you know, a couple of years ago, there was the talk about this transition tour with the ITF and kind of the restructuring of professional tennis. And so it never got to a point where I felt like I couldn't handle it. I think if anything, it helped just solidify my drive to dig in and deep. And I think that that's really where you see people are able to separate themselves. And what I've realized over the last 4 years that I've been at the USTA is that if you switch the way that you look at challenges, you realize that it actually provides incredible opportunities. So when I was going through the transition tour project, it actually gave me an opportunity to be in front of the board and senior leadership and people who I normally would not, where I was in my career then, have the opportunity to present in front of and show my work and the work of the team. And so that actually led to more exposure in the organization that then I think allowed for the opportunity for me to grow into these other areas that I'm working in now. So at the time it felt really tough and it was overwhelming and really exhausting, but it ended up being the best thing that could have ever happened to my career, right? So I think it's more about the idea of just when it gets tough, you know, you got to dig in and you can find solutions. And as long as you've kind of built a reputation where people like working with you and they know that, you know, you're going to work hard and that you're going to contribute to the team, I think then you can rely on those people when things get tough, and then you can kind of, you know, overcome tough circumstances to kind of come out ahead. And I think that's really been more so kind of the defining areas that I've really learned a lot from in the last kind of 4 years that I've been at the USDA.
Megan Rose is with us. She is, of course, with the USDA. I'm Brian Fenley. How would you compare the way in which you lead in the workplace to the way in which you're a mother, and how there might be some similarities in certain situations?
I yell a lot less at work. And people listen to me a lot more at work than they do, than my kids do. But yeah, look, I think I try to be an honest and real and transparent person. I mean, this kind of idea, I think especially over COVID, what I learned the most was that you have to be empathetic. You know, people are going through stuff. And I think with the kids, you try to be the same way, right? Like that you try to realize that they're just little kids and that they're feeling big feelings, or even if I don't understand why they might be behaving in a way, but that there is a reason. And I think that that's kind of been, I really care about the people that I work with and I really care about my team. And so, and I try to show that to them, because I think also not only is it important given the amount of time and effort and energy and time away that they are from their families. But also we just end up being better producers. You know, we end up being a more high performing team because we know that we actually care about who we are as people before we care about the work. And so, and honestly, I like to have fun. Like I liked it with the kids, you know, my idea of a great day is taking them to a theme park or going to do something fun. And with the team, I'm the same. You know, we're just trying to finalize our December retreat, and we're talking about going paintballing, or a couple years ago we went like go-karting. I beat everyone, although someone on my team will probably say that I'm a liar about that. But no, I mean, we try to, you know, I mean, I think at the end of the day it's just tennis, right? I mean, it's, yes, it's important, and yes, we're helping, you know, create opportunities for people to have careers in the sport, but at the end of the day it is tennis. And so I try to, you know, have fun and keep it light and make sure that we are able to laugh and have a good time and enjoy each other's company. But that at the end of the day, that we are, you know, we're doing the work, right? I mean, because it's great to have fun, but not if you're not being, if you're not good at your job, then none of that matters, right? So I would say those are probably the two similarities that, you know, between my parenting and my leadership. But I do say to my husband all the time, I'm like, how is it that I can somehow, you know, have the respect of 9 adults at work, and then I come home and two, you know, 2 children, like seemingly just don't hear me when I talk, but it's okay. I'll be okay with it. It's a good ego. It's a good, like, you know, keeping the ego in check.
Well, I think, Megan, as they get a little bit older, they'll listen to you a little bit more. Maybe we'll, it's just a stage. We'll see. At least let's tell ourselves that, and hopefully it does change. Megan Rose is with us. I'm Brian Fenley. How often do you go back and you think of what if, when it comes to your playing career, and if you spent more time, how you might've been able to continue on and made a bigger dent in the professional playing career?
Honestly, I don't. Tennis was a weird one for me. You know, I felt like I had a lot of natural gifts. I was a talented athlete and I was very competitive. The one thing I miss about playing is just the battle. I loved just the absolute battle of grinding out, like, you know, a 3-set match and it's tight and you're, you know, you don't get to fist pump in adult life anymore. You know, it's just like frowned upon apparently. So I do miss that part of it, but I mean, I achieved really everything that I wanted to. You know, I played at Junior Wimbledon. I played at the US Open. I won, you know, some rounds at US Open in doubles. I got to travel the world as a junior, and now I still, you know, get to travel the world and I still get to provide opportunities for people. And I get to watch these player development kids kind of come through the doors at the national campus and doing camps that I used to do 100 years ago. So I think everything worked out exactly the way that it was supposed to. You know, I think my husband likes to joke that when we met, he thought that he was, you know, going to end up being, you know, in my traveling entourage and be in the player box of all the slams. And then I kind of retired pretty much like immediately when we met. So jokes on him, but no, look, I don't have any regrets on that. I mean, you know, I'm in the Hall of Fame in Miami. Like, what more can I really ask for? You know,
Megan Rose, Brian Fenley. Final question for you. what is the best, when everybody, when they work, they want to have a source of validation. They want to know they're doing a good job. What's the best compliment that somebody could give you?
That's a good question. Oh man, that's a good one. I know you don't like dead air on these types of things.
No, but take your time. I did not.
I think ultimately, I think that if someone told me that they felt like I led with integrity, I mean, I think that would really be special, because I think all growing up, you know, like having good moral fiber and you know, leading with principle and values was something that my parents really instilled in me. And, you know, look, I think also, again, kind of going back to this idea of, you know, being a woman of color, like if anyone would ever say that, like, you know, what I've been able to accomplish in somehow like showed them that there was opportunity for them, you know, as a person of color in tennis, you know, that would, I think, probably like blow me away. So I would say probably one of those two things. But, you know, I mean, also just someone telling me that they like working at the USDA, you know, that I make it enjoyable for them. I think I would take that as well. So I'm pretty easy to to be. So, yeah, I think that's a good question. But, yeah, I think definitely having someone say that I'm a person of integrity, you know, in the workplace, I think is something that would be important.
Passion, pride, talent. These are all part of your weapons, if you will, to take a tennis term, to what makes you so successful and inspiring. Megan Rose, Managing Director, USTA Major Events, Team Leader, Team USA Tennis. I'm Brian Fenley with Fox Sports Radio and the USTA, helping out with the Challenger Tour. Megan, this was a lot of fun. Thanks for allowing us to dive into your life, learn about things that lead to how you've gotten to where you are today, your drive and your determination and all that goes through your mind as you've made this trek to the top of the corporate ladder of tennis on the corporate level. So thank you so much for your time, Megan. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Brian. I really appreciate it. I appreciate the opportunity.